Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Ryan Wade. Worlds Apart is a program that looks to investigate how racism, ethnocentrism, cultural and social divide manifest themselves within our society. Worlds Apart will consider the historic, scientific, cultural, and social factors that perpetuate these issues. Welcome to this special edition of Street Talk, where our program this evening will be looking at the issue of the death penalty. I was honored to be able to interview former governor of Illinois, Mr. George Ryan, in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, at a rally. And we were dealing with some of the issues surrounding a moratorium on the death penalty. Governor Ryan is noted for releasing 13 inmates from Illinois' death row and caused quite a firestorm throughout the country with respect to the issue of the death penalty. Should we have it? Should we have a moratorium? So what we'd like to do now is go to our interview with Governor George Ryan.
This is a real
state of Pennsylvania.
Well, I'm here to meet with a group to talk about the death penalty and to tell of my experience in Illinois when I put a moratorium on in the state and commuted the sentences of 167 prisoners on death row.
Why did you commute the sentences, Governor Ryan?
Because our system was faulted and broken and needs to be corrected, and there has been no attempt at this point to make the corrections that need to be made.
Governor Ryan, do you see that as a nationwide trend, though, this resistance to really address the death penalty?
I think it not only is a nationwide trend, I think it's an international trend. I think that the world is looking at the death penalty to say, is it really needed, and do we want the death penalty? And that's what we're here to talk about today.
Governor Ryan, stereotypically, people view Republicans and conservatives as people that aren't sensitive to these issues. I guess you're breaking that kind of a stereotype, aren't you?
Well, I was a solid supporter of the death penalty before I got elected governor. I recall back in 1977 as a member of the House when I voted to reinstate the death penalty in Illinois. And those that were voting against it stood up and said, those of you that are voting, how many would be willing to be the executioner? A pretty sobering thought. I didn't want to be the executioner, but I thought it was something that we needed to do. Little did I know that some 20 years later, as the elected governor, I would become the executioner. And that's when I realized how bad the system was when I had to make the decisions about it.
Governor Ryan, I know a lot of people don't tend to want to deal with this issue, but do you see that generally the people that are disproportionately impacted are people of color and poor people?
Well, there's any question that our system in Illinois is racist. And from what I've read, I think probably true in most cases. I don't know if it's by intent, but that's the way it works. If you're poor and minority, you can't afford the kind of representation that you need. You get different treatment at arrest. There's a whole series of things that play into it. So there isn't any question that the race issue is there and needs to be corrected.
Do you offer suggestions for other policymakers or governors in various states on how to approach this issue?
Well, I've tried not to. It's probably the most serious issue that you have to address as governor is the execution of another person. And I think each governor, and I've said this all along, has to be comfortable with their own situation. I was uncomfortable with ours because our system was broken. It was proven to me it was broken. We had 33 African Americans on the death row that had been sentenced by all white juries. We had 35 defendants that were represented in trial by lawyers that had later been suspended or disbarred from practice of law, so they didn't have the kind of defense that they needed. We had 45 people that were on death row as a result of single witnesses and jailhouse snitches. So the system needed to be corrected, and we needed to make some changes. And when I called the moratorium, I then appointed a committee to study it, and they made 85 recommendations for change.
Do you get calls from, though, other states in terms of those recommendations for change?
Well, I think, not personally, but I think that most other states have looked at it to see what they can do and to see, and from what I understand, most states have said they don't have the same problems that we have. But from what I know about Pennsylvania, there's a problem here, and they need to make some changes in their laws.
Okay, very good. Well, I'd like to thank you for doing this article. And again, for our viewing audience, this is Brian Wade reporting from the state capitol in Pennsylvania, Harrisburg, and I've been honored to have as my guest former Governor George Ryan. Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. Again, that was former governor of the state of Illinois, George Ryan. And again, as he said, he had really commuted the death penalty for over, I believe, 164 inmates. and had released 13 inmates from death row and freed them as a result of some work that were done by Northwestern journalism students. So it goes to show that our system, with respect to our criminal justice patterns, needs to probably be reexamined and to show maybe how we can go about better addressing these issues. I know in the future we're going to do a series of programs that will look at a Supreme Court commission in the state of Pennsylvania that talked about racial and gender bias. So what we'd like to do now is go to break. Stay tuned. We'll be right back to Worlds Apart.
Inside the dogs are weeping. Inside the circus of the wind. Inside the clocks are filled with sand. Inside you'll never hurt me. Inside the winter's cold.
Hi, I'm Brian Wade, host of the television program Worlds Apart. Looking for professional dry cleaners? Try Snow White. With four convenient locations, they'll do an excellent job on your clothes. Look what they did for me. Snow White Dry Cleaners.
Support for Worlds Apart is provided in part by York Foundation, a community foundation, and Susquehanna False Craft Company.
Kinsley is a proud sponsor of Worlds Apart. Kinsley is a full-service merit shop general contracting firm with more than 3 decades of construction experience. With various means of project delivery, including design, build, construction management services, plans, and spec bidding, our clients' options are endless.
Hola, si está en compra de una computadora nueva o usada, ven a Martinez Computer Repairs.
Hi, I'm Brian Wade. I got my computer at Martinez Computer and Repair. Stop in, they'll give you a great deal. Also, shipping anywhere in the United States.
Jim can cover all of your financial bases. Angel's first goal was to make it easy for you to bank online. Kent and his team can help your business grow. Isn't it nice to see a familiar face? We're People's Bank. For nearly 140 years, dependable, convenient, community banking. Where and when you need us most. Why not make your bank People's Bank? Here to help you manage all your money.
Why do you and me have to be?
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. If you're just now tuning in, we're into part three in our series on the criminal justice system. And for this program, we're looking at the issue of the death penalty. In our first segment, we had former governor of Illinois, George Ryan. In this segment, I had the opportunity to interview a district attorney from Luzerne County in Pennsylvania who favors the death penalty and believes that the system is not really broken. His name is Mr. Matt Mangino. And at this time, we'd like to run the tape and show that interview. Street Talk and Worlds Apart. I'm here with District Attorney Matt Mangino from Lawrence County in Pennsylvania. And prior to this interview, I interviewed the former governor of Illinois, Governor George Ryan, who is a proponent for a moratorium and ultimately maybe the abolishment of the death penalty. I know several people have been commuted in his state. And in Pennsylvania, there is a clear, divisive argument over should we have a moratorium? Or how should we best approach the death penalty? And I understand that, District Attorney Mangino, that you are an opponent of a moratorium, basically?
I am an opponent of a moratorium, but you know we have to look at the facts in Pennsylvania. We're in the midst of a de facto moratorium. And we haven't executed anyone who hasn't requested to be executed in Pennsylvania since we reinstituted the death penalty. There's been 3 executions. All 3 of those prisoners consented to their execution. So we're in the midst of a de facto moratorium as it is.
Well, what about the sentencing that have basically kept people in prison for years and they were innocent?
Well, you know, when you look at the whole picture, not only the state of Pennsylvania, but across the country, you know, there are 7,300 people who have been sentenced to death in this country. Death penalty opponents talk about of 111 people that have been exonerated. Exactly. Some of those 111, aren't factually innocent, You know, they got new trials, witnesses disappeared. I mean, some of those people are factually innocent. In fact,
right.
In fact, 12 or 13 of them have been exonerated by way of DNA evidence.
Correct.
But that's, you know, that's less than 0.5% of all death penalties across the country. You know, the system's not broken. The system works.
Okay. And so when you say the system's not broken, but when you're falsely putting people in prison that don't belong there and have been there for 10, 15, 20, maybe 30 years, how would you feel if you were in their place? Would you feel that, well, the system's not broken?
Well, I think what you have to look at is that the system works. I mean, these people have been exonerated. You know,
okay.
We have an appellate process. We have a process of review. That's not a sign that the system doesn't work. That's a sign that it does work. When the Supreme Court says, you have to go back and retry this case, that's not a sign that the system doesn't work. That's a sign that the system does work. You can't look at the trial court in a microcosm, okay? You have to look at the whole process. We have appellate review. We have post-conviction review. And when cases are sent back and overturned, that's a sign that the system works. In fact, the United States Supreme Court has said that people on death row, they don't only have due process, they have super due process. And that's what the Supreme Court said about it.
Do you think there's a problem when you look at a profile that most of the people that are impacted are disproportionately African-American minority and poor?
Well, one thing that you have to take into consideration is you have to look at the right analysis when you look at racial disparity. When you look at the fact that in Pennsylvania that 13% of the population is minority, yet 60% of the population on death row is minority, you say, wow, there's a problem. But you're not looking at the right numbers here. I mean, you can't look at the population generally and then look at people on death row. You have to look at whites who have been convicted of first-degree murder and minorities who have been convicted of first-degree murder. And when you find that, when you look at those percentages, you'll find that 63% of first-degree murders are committed by minorities. That corresponds with the number of people who are on death row. When you do the proper analysis, I think you find that there isn't a racial disparity.
What about proper representation within the court systems? You know, as far as maybe some of the people that are basically defending these individuals, are they being adequately represented?
Well, there was a study that was done by the Pennsylvania Supreme Court, a commission on race and gender bias. And, what they said is that there was a poor representation in some areas with regard to homicide, particularly death penalty cases. But then they went on to say something very interesting. They said that in Philadelphia, the representation is adequate and is probably better than any other area in the state. Yet 135 of the 240 people who are on death row are from Philadelphia, where they're getting adequate representation. Certainly myself, and I know the District Attorney's Association, supports adequate funding and resources for representation of people who are charged not only with first-degree murder, but are charged with any criminal offense and are unable to afford representation.
So based on what you've told me, then, you still think that the system works well and doesn't need fix, correct?
Any system can always use review and use tweaking. But I think when you look at the numbers, the death penalty in this country is probably the most accurately imposed sentence or punishment in the world. I mean, 99.5% accuracy. You don't find that in any other endeavor anywhere. If Sammy Sosa was batting .995, he'd be in the Hall of Fame right now. So, I mean, the system works. It's not broken.
All I would say, though, to the Sammy Sosa analogy, though, that's not dealing with a person's life, wouldn't you say?
No, it's not. It certainly isn't. But nothing is infallible. Okay, and the Supreme Court of the United States and the Supreme Court of Pennsylvania has said that the death penalty is an appropriate sanction under certain circumstances. And as a prosecutor, it's my responsibility to uphold the laws of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania.
Whatever breath's in my mouth, whatever the sweetest wine.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. I'm Brian Wade. Again, that was District Attorney Matt Mangino from Lawrence County in Pennsylvania. And again, he favors the death penalty, and that was my interview with him. What we're getting ready to do is we've taped a segment that was part of a press conference that was held by the Pennsylvania Abolitionists United Against the Death Penalty that was in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. And what you're going to see is Mr. Jeff Garris, who's the president or the executive director of the group. And eventually that will lead into, again, Governor Ryan giving his presentation during that press conference. So what we're going to do now is we're going to pause some words from our sponsors. Stay tuned. We'll be right back to Worlds Apart.
Never those dark clouds hide. Never those dark.
Welcome to Ruffin's Jazz Club and Restaurant, York's Jazz Melting Pot. We feature live bands every weekend. We have a diverse and wonderful crowd that merges the cultures, people, and music of York. We serve dinner and appetizers till close every night. Stop by and visit us.
Hershey Foods Corporation supports the efforts of Worlds Apart in promoting the understanding, acceptance, and value of diversity.
There are many paths in life. Is your career on the right one? You're going full steam, but in the right direction? Without a college education, your career might veer off track. Elizabethtown College offers an adult degree program called Excel. Excel accepts your prior college credits, your professional experience, and your desire to learn, and offers you a flexible, affordable way to earn your degree. If you've been looking everywhere for a sign to steer your education back on track, we'd like to offer a word of encouragement. Call or click to learn more.
I'm your host, Brian Wade. If you're just now tuning in, we're into part three on our series dealing with social justice and the criminal justice system within America. And this segment, we're going to go to a press conference that was held by the Pennsylvania Abolitionists Against the Death Penalty. Also in that, you'll hear Mr. Jeff Garris, and additionally, you'll hear Governor George Ryan again basically speaking during that press conference. Much has been said about this issue of the death penalty. And regardless to what your position is, the question is, what are we going to do as a society to try to find a more just way of addressing this issue? So what we'd like to do now is go to this press conference, and you'll be hearing first Mr. Jeff Garris.
I'm the executive director of Pennsylvania Abolitionists United Against the Death Penalty. We're a grassroots organization, more than 8,000 strong across the state of Pennsylvania. We are pushing for a moratorium on executions in this state. We have been joined in this effort by the bar associations, by many groups, including 10 city governments here in Pennsylvania, and most recently, this spring, by the Pennsylvania State Supreme Court Committee on Race and Gender Bias, which cited extreme racial bias in the application of the death penalty in Pennsylvania and inadequate defense standards, and called on Governor Rendell and the legislature to immediately halt executions in Pennsylvania. We are very pleased today to have with us several guests who I would describe as people who are my heroes, people who I look up to for their courage, for their leadership, and for demanding the highest standard of justice in the application of our laws here in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and across the United States of America. We have a number of events coming up over the next few days. I think most of you are aware of those. They're in your press packs as well. I'm going to move very quickly into an introduction of someone who I've had the pleasure of getting to know over the last 4 or 5 years in this state as we struggle towards a halt to executions, and for people like me and for people like the person to my right, toward the ultimate abolition of the death penalty in Pennsylvania.
Be the one that can introduce the person that I admire most in this entire country, that had the foresight and the guts, let's say, to do something about the death penalty. I guess I can't say too much more about him, because he's a particular individual himself that we should all be proud of. And now I'd like to introduce you to Governor Ryan.
Thank you, Senator. Thanks very much for the introduction. I certainly want to thank Jeff Garris and the Pennsylvania Abolitionists United Against the Death Penalty for the invitation to be here with you today and talk about a cause that I have come full circle on, frankly. I have gone from a total supporter of the death penalty to a supporter of abolition. and it's based on the history and the experience that I had in my own state in Illinois. I was elected in November of 1998 and took office as governor in January of 1999. In February of that year, my wife and I were watching television at the mansion in Illinois, watching the news, something I don't make a practice of, frankly. But we were watching the news, and there's this young, well, not young, fellow comes out, he's released from prison by the name of Anthony Porter. Spent 15 years on death row as an innocent individual, and he had some mental challenges that should have prohibited him from even being put on death row, frankly. But he had been there for 15 years, and I said to my wife, I can't imagine how in a system that's supposed to be the best in the world that could ever happen. How can an innocent man be on death row for 15 years with the appeal setup that's there, with the whole system? I couldn't understand that. So I started to look into the system a little bit to see why Anthony Porter had been in prison. That was in February. In March, the first case comes to me for execution, a fellow by the name of Andrew Corky Ellis. And Corky Ellis was a bad guy. He did a lot of bad, terrible things, and some horrendous crimes. He used to pull young women off the street and mutilate them and rape them and murder them and throw them back out on the street. And he was convicted of this crime and sentenced to die. And I was to sign his execution. And I said to myself, after having been through the Anthony Porter case, is this fellow really guilty? And I want to make sure he is if he's going to die. Now, I still believe that the death penalty was an important part of our process. I, to satisfy my own questions, called on everybody that was involved in the case. I brought them into my office. I talked with them. I talked to prosecutors. I talked to people in the community. I talked to defendants. And in the end, I was told by a lot of people that in the name of justice, that Anthony Corky Ellis ought to be executed, and that he was absolutely guilty. Well, I was convinced, finally, that he was guilty, and the execution went ahead. That's one of those things that's bothered me ever since I've done it. It still bothers me that I executed this guy. But there was no...
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. That was part of the press conference held by the Pennsylvania Abolitionists United Against the Death Penalty, and we're going to come back for some final thoughts on this issue regarding the death penalty. So what we'd like to do now is pause some words from our sponsors. We're in part three in our series looking at the criminal justice system, also social justice in America. So for Worlds Apart, stay tuned. We'll be right back.
A better way to push your merchandise. You get more than you bargained for in our classifieds.
And one of the great things that can happen in a university is to meet people, to learn from those who are different than we are, to experience different cultures.
Unless you sit down and talk with people and get to know them, there's too many stereotypes.
Multiculturalism and being sensitive to multicultural audiences and peers is the right thing to do, no question about it. But it's also a critical business skill.
So it's very important that the students realize that this is one of the skill sets that they will need to be effective when they leave Penn State.
When you want words like skilled, expert, and nationally recognized. When you need to have confidence as well as courage. When it's your health, your body, your life. We have the finest team of specialists waiting to help. WellSpan Health, the region's most comprehensive healthcare system. WellSpan Health, for the journey that is life.
That all men are free.
called on everybody that was involved in the case. I brought them into my office. I talked with them. I talked to prosecutors. I talked to people in the community. I talked to defendants. And in the end, I was told by a lot of people that in the name of justice, that Anthony Korkialis ought to be executed, and that he was absolutely guilty. Well, I was convinced, finally, that he was guilty, and the execution went ahead. That's one of those things that's bothered me ever since I've done it. It still bothers me that I executed this guy. But there was no question in my mind that he was guilty. But I said to myself, I don't want to go through this process again. I don't want to have to make this tough decision about who's going to live and who's going to die. And so I called for a moratorium on the death penalty after learning some more faults within the system. One of the local papers in Chicago came out with a whole series of faults after a study and a review, where they found that just a lot of things wrong with the system, and most of you here know what that study is.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. I hope you've gained some insight into the controversy surrounding the death penalty. It's not something that's going to go away soon. And I know for some people, they're looking for justice. We did a two-part series with Dr. Jones from Messiah College, where he talked about the restorative challenge with respect to our criminal justice system. And one of his points was he thinks that people basically are looking basically at the death penalty as a piece for revenge. And again, in our society and throughout the world, is revenge going to be the ultimate key that helps us become more whole or holistic or come at peace with one another regarding how we address this issue when somebody is murdered by another individual? Does the death penalty really create or cause a deterrent? There's been a lot of studies that say no. But one of the questions is, how can we best address our society? Must we look at some preventive and proactive kinds of measures that might create a more equitable and more peaceful and more just society? Could that have a correlation in reducing the kinds of crimes that we see in our society? One thing for sure, we must all work together in a spirit of love to try to address all the issues within our society, whether it be education, whether it be housing, politics. But the death penalty is an issue that still needs to be addressed. And we're hoping that maybe within the state of Pennsylvania, they may consider a moratorium. I know Senator Helfrich has been at the lead at addressing this issue and other groups. Mr. Jeff Garris through the PA Abolitionists United Against the Death Penalty, our ardent former Attorney General Ernie Preate has been an advocate with respect to trying to bring about a moratorium. So for several groups trying to address this issue, it won't go away, but we're hopeful that we can come to some resolution. For Worlds Apart, I'm Brian Wade. And I also want to remind you that the music that we were listening to this evening was by Sting from his CD, Sacred Love. For Worlds Apart, I'm Brian Wade. Good evening, good night, and God bless.